welcome into another edition of Last Call on the Next Round. I am Lance Taylor, presented by Redmont Vodka. We've got special guest Clay Travis.
Yes.
From Outkick, founder of Outkick, part of the Fox family, including Fox Bet Live, author of Dixieland Delight, Republicans Buy Sneakers Too, Man the Book, which we will get to.
Fantastic.
In a little bit. It's been a while, right?
Yeah, been a long time.
Also, the Clay Travis and Buck Sexton show.
That's right.
Which we will get to that in a little bit. Appreciate you coming on. Cheers.
Cheers.
So we've got three different vodka drinks coming from Redmont Vodka.
Yeah.
This is the Sabanade.
This is the what?
Sabanade.
Sabanade. So this is just lemonade with vodka, I'm assuming.
Well, it's Redmont Vodka, cranberry, orange juice, and pineapple.
Yeah, I'm going to taste it.
Tell me what you think.
Oh, that's really good. You want to drink out of the straw?
I'm just going back and forth.
All right. No, it's good. That's really tasty.
I wanted you to look feminine.
Yeah, I know. That's why you set me up for it early.
So you and I have known each other since 2006, and I've told the story before. The first time I ever had you on the show, old producer of mine, Harry Long, said you need to have this guy who writes for CBS Sportsline. He has done the top 10 candidates to replace Mike Shula at Alabama.
Yes.
Number one on your list was exhume the body of Bear Bryant. I was like, I got to have this guy on the show.
That's right.
We were doing, when I was doing radio then, we were doing a live broadcast from the Cheetah in Atlanta.
Which I can't believe you got away with.
People were bitching and complaining. They hated us doing it from the Cheetah until you came on.
Yes.
And then when you talked about exhuming Bear Bryant, people were like,
they didn't even care about the strip club anymore. They were angry that I would say that.
All about you. And then I was like, we got a winner here.
Yes. Hey, as long as people are paying attention, good or bad, which is kind of rare.
Well, and so for the last 15 years, you and I have been hanging out and doing stuff.
That's right.
I think, you know, one of the first times before you got big, I was helping out with an event called the Lord Wedgwood Charity.
Yeah, that's right.
And we got you to come in to Birmingham as one of the celebrities.
Yes.
Back before you were a true celebrity. And I remember one of the conversations we broke away and we were talking to Rick Neuheisel.
Yeah.
And do you remember Rick Neuheisel?
He brought his guitar and was playing songs and everything else.
But he was explaining the Keanu Reeves point break.
Oh, yeah, that was great.
That I think at that point he was the quarterback's coach at UCLA and he was a technical advisor point break. And he was trying to teach Keanu Reeves how to take a snap.
Couldn't throw a football.
Couldn't throw a football.
Yeah.
And in mid-conversation, you spit on Rick Neuheisel.
I did. I forgot about that. Literally landed right on his chest. And it kind of hung there, but I think he saw it and, like, knocked it off.
Like a professional. Like
at quick, that quick. Point in time, Rick Neuheisel was, like, what, 20 times as famous as me?
At least.
At least. You think I think I've equaled Rick Neuheisel now.
I think your net worth has surpassed Rick Neuheisel.
Oh, certainly it probably has. Although he made a lot of money in the gambling pools, remember?
Apparently.
Back in the day.
And if he would have hung on a lot longer, he would have made a lot more in buyouts.
But he's a great,
he's a great dude.
He's a good dude and a great guitar player. Because later that night, he broke out the guitar, remember, in the bar after, I think that was the, that the night.
He actually got on stage.
Yeah, that's
was
right.
Was playing with the band.
Was that the night before the contest or the night after the contest, like after the golf?
It was the night before the golf.
Okay.
Yeah.
So he's a fantastic dude, but yeah, I totally forgot. I spit on him.
You know, the funny thing, the very next year, I don't know if you remember this, they actually sent a plane to get a few of you guys.
Yeah.
And you were on a plane with T.R. Dunn, former Alabama basketball great.
That's right.
Bobby Johnson.
That's right.
The coach for Vanderbilt, and you, small plane, and you look over, and is gas not coming out of the wing?
Yeah, it was Greg Bromberg's plane, I think.
Greg Bromberg sent it up for you.
Yeah. And so we were on the plane, and we're flying, and all of a sudden there's jet fuel coming out of the off the side of the plane. Lots of jet fuel. And Bobby Johnson and I are kind of sitting there, and we're looking out the window. I mean, it's, you know, a 5 or 6 seat jet or plane or whatever you want to call it. And we were like, hey, this seems like it's kind of a big deal. And they were like, don't worry about it. We're fine.
Yeah, and I mean, so, he was like cracking a paper. You would think he'd be better than a 3-9 coach if he, like, the pressure didn't bother him of a plane going down. Right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it wasn't Bobby Johnson. It was the whoever was flying the plane was like, hey, your guy's going to be fine. I've never been on a plane before and seen all the jet fuel just shooting out the window. And I'm not a super nervous airplane guy because my thing on an airplane is whenever you get on an airplane, you've given up all control of your life.
And that's why I hate it. I hate it.
I understand.
I can't get comfortable.
I understand people who can't, but like, there's nothing I could do to save the plane, right? Like, if the plane's going to go down, like, it's not like they're going to be like, Clay, get up there and save it, right? So you kind of just got to sit back and let the professional make the decision. And so We ended up landing in Nashville, and I'm still here, so Bobby Johnson, too.
So this is Last Call, presented by Redmont Vodka here on the Next Round with Clay Travis. I'm Lance Taylor. So going back to your old radio days in Nashville, and I think it was on 3HL. I'm not exactly sure, but you said the word penis.
Yeah.
It's amazing how beat up we get in society over certain words.
Yeah.
But people wanted you fired for saying penis.
Yeah, that was really funny. That was early in my local news radio tenure, or local sports radio tenure. And if you remember the Brett Favre sexual harassment.
Well, he sent out a dick pic, right?
That was the allegation. I don't know if it's 100% true or not. But
wait, was it Jen Sturger or was it
Jen Sturger? That's right, Jen Sturger, who was like a reporter for the Jets or something. She was an employee of the Jets, and so it was controversial because there was a potential sexual harassment aspect associated with it. So that story was massive. And Brett Favre had just signed, I think, with the Vikings. And when he signed with the Vikings, he was doing a press conference, and he was talking about all of his body health. And he was like, my shoulder's a little bit hurt, my hip's a little dinged up, my ankle's a little bad, and I just was jumping in during the audio that we were playing. I was like, my penis is great, which I thought was really, really funny. And so I just kept jumping in to use the word penis. And phone lines were flooded. Flooded in Nashville, and I remember the program director sent me an email, which is a really funny email. I could probably find it and read it, about how, like, we were going to pay for this and the ratings, like, we were going to, you know, really have to be worried about this. But we took calls, and a lot of times people run from controversy. People were furious, and so we had an old man call in.
Wait, I got to stop you. It wasn't like one or two people, like masses of people.
They said, you never really know. You know, like, we live in this era where people are like, oh, everybody's so mad about this. And, you know, it might be 20 people tweeting or, you know, like 20 people calling the station, which could mean that the other 90% of people thought it was funny, but the 10% who were calling in. So my thing is all the time, go to calls, right? If people disagree with me, we'll just have it out. And so this old man called in. And he was like, I just want you to know, I'm driving in the car with my wife. We are 78 years old, and I am, you know, scandalized. I couldn't, old Southern accent, you know, like, I mean, like my grandpa. And so a lot of people would have been like, oh, I'm so sorry. I apologize for what I did. I said, hey, you know, my goal was to make sure I never offend you again. I'm not like I had it planned. I was like, I'm going to run through a list of body terms, and I want you to tell me if it's okay for me to say it on the radio. And the first one I said was bottom. And he was like, you know, in deep Southern accent, that's borderline.
And bottom.
Bottom was borderline for him. So my point on that is, most people who claim to be offended, no matter who they are, if you talk to them long enough, you will establish that they are not representative of the majority opinion. It's also great radio, because and content in general, because people love conflict. Every great story has a conflict, right? And so it can be you versus a caller. It can be, you know, the reason why people care about sports is because there's a winner and a loser. There's a conflict. The game is a conflict. Football is more violent than baseball might be, but the conflict between two teams is what provokes the interest. If everybody wins or if everybody loses, nobody cares.
But
there's
what
no
was
stakes.
The conflict here, penis?
The conflict was me versus the caller over what words are appropriate to say on Nashville, Tennessee radio.
And this is it's a grandfather, right?
Probably.
Yeah.
But, I mean, his perspective on what could be said was different than mine, and I think it led to good radio. But my point on it is, a lot of people's natural reaction is to turn away from conflict. They seek to avoid it. And if you seek to avoid it or you apologize, it makes it look like you feel like you did something wrong. I'll apologize if I get a fact wrong or something like that, but I don't think you should apologize for your opinion or your sense of humor. And I think we live in an era where people are so quick to apologize for their opinion or their sense of humor that ultimately what ends up happening is whoever likes you, you lose them too. It's like when I said the First Amendment and boobs on CNN, they wanted me to apologize. And I said, no, I'm not going to apologize. That's a funny line. And also, it's not my fault if somebody gets offended, right? Like, this world that we live in, we're somehow, like, we're in a crowded bar right now. If somebody says something offensive in the bar, like, I don't think it's brave of me to be like, oh, I'm offended. We have so incentivized victimization that people believe if they are offended, it gives them some sort of moral legitimacy. My thing is, and I've said this for years on the radio, whenever somebody says they're offended, if you respond, I'm offended that you're offended, you blow their mind. Because they think that being offended is a one-way street.
I think what is so refreshing is when people are actually able to speak their minds, say something, it's controversial, and then they don't have to apologize. Example, Brian Kelly at Notre Dame, after they beat Florida State.
I'm in favor of it, yeah.
Talking about his favorite execution, and people are like, he's going to get fired. And I'm like, if they fire him, good. Don't apologize. Stick to it.
No, and he didn't. And to his credit, look, not every joke lands perfectly. And what I always say is, we've created a lot of hanging juries, right? Social media is a hanging jury. You tweet something or you say something on radio or TV that people don't like, and the immediate response is, you've got to fire that person, right? I think we've created a culture where firing is a normal occurrence. And that doesn't exist in the real world. Like, if you have a normal job and you do a bad job for a portion of your job, nobody's like, oh my God, you gotta fire this guy or this girl immediately. And so I think we've created an artificial dynamic through cancel culture where a lot of people sort of accede or acquiesce to the idea of, oh, the way this story ends is somebody gets fired. I just reject it, right? And the truth of the matter is, almost nothing lasts more than 24 hours, right?
It's because something else buries it.
Something else buries it. So my theory is, say exactly what I think. People can like it or not like it. You've known me for 15 years now. I don't think, you know, if this camera weren't going, if you and I were just sitting here having a drink, I don't think you can tell people, but I don't think I would sound much different with the camera on or off. And I think that's why Outkick works, and that's why I've had success, because for better or worse, authenticity is rare. And I think there's a desperate, we live in such an inauthentic era that I think there's this desperation for authenticity. And that's what I try to do.
And hopefully it'll circle back. By the way, this is Last Call on the Next Round, presented by Redmont Vodka. We're at the Innisfree Irish Pub. Great atmosphere, Ole Miss, Alabama. We might talk a little football.
Well, this is a good question for you. You've been out with me in bars all over the place. I get asked a lot, hey, what kind of reaction do you get out in public? I've never had anybody say a mean word to me. Back when we were at the Winfrey and the fans would show up.
People talk a lot of shit behind the scenes, and especially when they're anonymous on Twitter.
That's right.
On Facebook.
But I've never had anybody say anything.
I've never seen it.
Yeah.
And I'm a little surprised based on the amount of times.
Well, not only that, I mean, people are drinking heavily. So you would think their inhibitions are reduced even more. I mean, people are getting ready for the game tomorrow, and there's almost nobody who, I mean, I'll be stunned if I, because I've been doing this for, you know, 15 years or whatever it is.
So we met in 2006, and before that was the pudding strike in the Virgin Islands.
Yeah.
And that would be a lot bigger today, wouldn't it? I mean, it was big then.
Yeah, I mean, I think so.
So just to set that
the
up,
timing on,
you were living in the Virgin Islands. You were practicing law.
Yeah.
You could not get Sunday ticket on
NFL
TV.
Sunday ticket was not
because you were a Titans fan.
Yeah. You only got the national game. So NFL Sunday ticket was not available because DirecTV didn't come to the U.S. Virgin Islands. And so this was 2004. At the time, I was 25 years old, and I hit on the idea. Somebody was on a hunger strike because they couldn't vote for president in the U.S. Virgin Islands. And so I was like, well, the presidential vote's kind of a big deal. What's a ridiculous and absurd twist on a hunger strike for something that is way less significant, right? Like, I wanted to be able to watch the Tennessee Titans. And so I came up with the idea of a pudding strike, where I would only eat, like, Hunt snack pack puddings, and I would write about it. And it was, you know, just absurdly ridiculous enough, and that's how I started writing online.
Now, how long, though, did the pudding strike go?
I don't even remember now. I mean, I cheated on the pudding strike a lot.
You had to.
Yeah.
Well, were you starving?
It was, like, 60 days. Yeah, something like 60 days.
So what do you think of the Saban aid?
Save and Age's pretty good. It's, yeah. I mean, I think it's really, I mean, it doesn't taste like there's alcohol in it, which is a both a good and bad sign, right? Because you could pound a lot of these and not know we got a different one to taste.
Different way.
Now, what is this one?
This is just a John Daly,
yeah.
Which is Redmont Tea and Lemonade.
Oh, I like it too.
The cinnamon is a little tart, but
I like them both.
Yeah, that works.
Yeah, this is solid.
Okay, so I inadvertently met you the first time before 2006, and I discovered this, and I think I told you, Dixieland Delight, when I was reading it. I was at a Monday night football game in Tennessee, and I was doing a Monday night show from the press box, and at halftime of that game, they brought different people out on the field.
Yeah.
If you could catch a punt, yeah. Then you want a key, and if that key works, you want a Mountaineer.
So the way it worked, Tennessee Titan game against the Philadelphia Eagles. It was the opening game of the season. My dad has season tickets in the north end zone, and somebody, I was in t-shirt, shorts, and flip-flops.
That's
which
the way you
basically
are.
What I wear.
Where you are right now.
Well, I had to put on pants for TV, but I was sitting there, and they came up and said, hey, do you want to be in the halftime contest? I said, sure. So I went out onto the field, and they had the jugs machine set up, and they said, hey, you're going to have to catch a 25 and a 40-yard punt. You start off with a 25-yarder, and then you go to the 40-yarder. And if you caught both of them, you got to come back to the final game of the season, which was Monday Night Football.
Now, did you go hands or did you catch the body?
I mean, mostly hands, but I also brought it into my chest, you know, like pretty quickly. I didn't want to catch it straight off the chest because I didn't want it to pop off, right? So I had two pretty seamless catches. I mean, the bigger concern than the catch was I didn't want to have to go over the shoulder. You know, a lot of people can't judge, right? Like, if you haven't ever played baseball or you haven't played, like, seeing the ball come out of the jugs machine and knowing whether you need to come in 2 yards or go back 2 yards is pretty significant. So the most important thing is just putting yourself in a position to catch. And I got pretty good hands, so I won that. Came back, Monday Night Football, Titans against the Patriots, and they had six of us there, and I drew a key out of a Titans helmet that started the Mercury Mountaineer, and I won an SUV and a pontoon boat.
I mean, I remember it vaguely. I just remember somebody winning the Mountaineer,
yeah.
And it's just hard to believe years later.
That was me.
Here we sit.
It was the first car I ever had.
Well, I remember you staying at my house in Birmingham, and that piece of shit was in my front yard because you drove it. You drove the wheels off of it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I took it to the Caribbean. I brought it back from the Caribbean. I mean, it had well over 100,000 miles on it. I mean, I don't think I bought a new car myself until like 5 or 6 years ago. I mean, I drove that Mercury Mountaineer. I bought a used car. I mean, I'm not a huge car guy in general. Now I'm kind of a douchebag and I drive around in a Range Rover. Tricked out Range Rover on top of.
Of course.
And my wife's got an Escalade.
When are you getting the G-Wagon? That's soon, right?
You know, I was trying to decide between the G-Wagon and the Range, and I like the Range more.
Hey, this is Last Call in the next round, presented by Redmont Vodka. We're live at the Innisfree Irish Pub in Tuscaloosa, getting ready for Ole Miss in Alabama. I love it.
By the way, my car cost, and I've leased, the car cost twice as much as my condo did that I lived in for a decade.
Okay, well, I want to ask you about money. We might as well just, you know, break the silence about that, because when I first met you, you were living like a normal person lives.
Yeah.
And let's just go to COVID real quick. So, as bad as COVID was for a lot of businesses, there were some businesses that thrived. And it's
Amazon.
Just really interesting that you come across certain people in certain industries and it blew up.
Amazon, Netflix.
Clay Travis. Did COVID, based on the political separation, did it make you rich, the COVID?
I was already rich. It made me richer.
How about this? Did it take you to another level?
I think so. And I think it did, because what it did was illuminate the distance, which I already knew existed, but I think a lot of people didn't, between the people who cover sports and the people who are fans of sports. And it still is staggering to me that I was one of the only people who fought to play college football last year. I said, hey, you look at the data, it's safe to do. I mean, hell, I think we could have had full stadiums. There's a higher COVID positivity rate now than there was last September, And I think what it illuminated was just that gap, right, between sports media who were curled up in the fetal position and didn't believe that it was safe possible to play sports, and I can name them, but people know who they are, and people like me who looked at the data and said, no, like, we got to find a way to do this. And I didn't know if we'd win. There was a period of time in July when I thought all of college football would get canceled. But it's one of the things that I'm most proud of, that I think at Outkick, for everybody that we employed and myself as well, that we found a way to make that possible.
Well, tell me if I'm off on this, but when I first met you, you had liberal views. Some liberal views.
I don't think it's so much liberal as libertarian.
Okay.
Like, I believe in individuals' right to make choices for themselves, to take risks that they believe. And
well, here was going to be my point, though.
Yeah.
So you've got, where we sit right now, 98% staunch Republicans,
Trump,
right?
Trump supporters,
no doubt.
Yeah.
So you voted at one particular point for Obama. But I try to tell people, so Clay is a sensible guy.
Yeah.
And I think people that read you and listen to you, they know that. But you saw that our world was getting so crazy, you kind of adjusted where
I don't even think I've moved, LT. I think I've been the exact same place, and the world has shifted around it. Like, if you look at, you know, use, for instance, Barack Obama's 2008 presidential campaign. He ran on American exceptionalism, on how amazing it was that he, as a mixed-race Hawaiian kid with no dad who lived in America, could rise to the office of presidency, was a testament to American exceptionalism. Bill Clinton ran as the boy from Hope, Arkansas, right? A place called Hope. They sold the idea of America as an exceptional place and used their story as a way to justify the rise and the evolution of America. Clinton's 1992 and 96 campaigns would be Republican campaigns now. Even Barack Obama in 2008, I think, would be a Republican campaign. I think the Democratic Party lost its mind and went so far left that I, who was always kind of a middle of the road, look at the facts, I'm not a diehard partisan, now I've gone from a, you know, fairly conservative Republican to a, you know, somewhat normal mainstream Republican, and I haven't moved. The world has just spun around. I think Ronald Reagan said, I didn't leave the Democratic Party, the Democratic Party left me, because he initially was a Democrat, and then he ended up obviously the most successful Republican president probably of the 20th century almost, and that's kind of where I feel like I am.
Well, you know, we don't get into politics on the next round. I mean, we're probably not intelligent enough to do it, but it's just best to stay away from typically, but I think our world has gone insane.
Yeah,
so
I don't even see it, and I say this on my radio
because,
show
like,
that I
our
do
our escapism is like talking about entertainment and sports.
Yeah, I say, to me, there's not really Democrat and Republican anymore. They're sane and insane. And I try to be on the side of sanity.
Yeah, and
to me, figuring out a way to play football is sane. Saying, hey, we got to curl up in the fetal position and stay in the basement is insane.
Okay, so it's last call in the next round, presented by Redmont Vodka. We're at the Innisfree Irish Pub in Tuscaloosa. Just a little bit more, a couple more sips of this. We've got one more coming for you.
Okay.
You're drinking really slow, by the way.
Well, I don't know how many drinks I got coming. I'm drinking the same speed as you.
Okay, so I want to ask you, you missed the last one, by the way. So you talked about you really don't get confronted in bars. People do tweet really mean things, though.
At me?
Yeah.
Oh.
So I've got one right here.
Oh, somebody sent to me?
Yeah.
Oh.
And this is a couple weeks ago. Clay Travis might be the dumbest son of a bitch on Twitter. I hope he chokes on a bag of dicks. Now, choking on a bag of dicks is like...
Well, first of all, I don't know what that is. Well, also, like, why would I start eating the bag of dicks?
That's
like,
a good
that,
point.
I mean, that, like, okay, like, you want me to die, you want me to choke, but, like, I wouldn't be like, there's a bag of dicks, let me start eating them, they look really good, and then I would choke on them. Like, it doesn't really seem
but,
like
but,
it makes
but that
sense.
That seems like extreme hate, doesn't it? I mean, how can you piss somebody off that bad where they want you to choke
well,
on
I
a bag
mean,
of
you
dicks?
Just saw my reaction to it. I think it's funny. Like, to me, the person who loses their temper has lost, right? So I very rarely lose my temper.
I was going to get to that. I know what gets you upset, though. I'll let you finish your point, but I know what you're
saying. I don't spend much time reading the mentions. Like, we have fun with them. Like, I'll have people go through them and pick out the worst things people say to me, like that I hadn't seen, and just react to it naturally. Like, just kind of logically work through. Like, well, if you're hoping that I'm going to choke on a bag of dicks, first of all, I don't know that's a product you can buy. One. Two, I don't know that I'd be like, hey, what'd you have? I was thinking about the nachos, but I went with the bag of dicks instead. I don't think there are very many people in Innisfree who'd be like, hey, what are you going to go with? You know, well, look at this menu. Man, those nachos look really good. I'm a big fan of quesadillas, but I'm really in a bag of dicks mood right now. Like, I just don't think there are very many people who would do that.
Okay, but...
And so, you know, like, that's funny to me that somebody would send that. And also, like, when you get somebody so illogically angry, like, I'll give you an example. When I started making picks on who I thought would win games, you see this because you make picks.
God.
When you're
people
wrong,
people get pissed.
They don't ever come and be like, hey, yeah, very rarely.
Thanks for the 4-1
yeah,
today.
Yeah, very rarely do they ever say, boy, you know, everybody else was saying that other side, you nailed this one. Man, thanks for making me so much money. They wait to see what the result is, and then they call you out for being an idiot. And I used to think that was kind of strange, but then I started thinking, man, this is wild. Imagine that whatever team you root for just got an incredible win. The first thing you think is, I'm going to get my phone and tell Clay Travis what an idiot he is. That's like money in the bank, because you are so concerned with what I think that your first thought is, I have to go tell that guy what I think about what he thought, right? I'm just a random dude, right? I mean, I don't know about you, but like, when great things happen in my life, the first thing I think isn't, I'm going to go brag to somebody who I don't even know about how amazing it is. Like, you wouldn't be like, hey, I just got a raise at work. I'm going to go get my phone, and I'm going to tweet right to Joe Biden about how much he sucks because I just got a raise.
But I will tell you, there has to be a point where, because I've never seen you get upset, there has to be a point where when you first started looking at Twitter, there were some comments that maybe beat you up a little bit, because what I would do is just mute them. I didn't block anybody.
Yeah.
I would just mute them. I didn't want to see them again. I didn't respond.
My only thing is, come at me. Right? Like, I kind of have a mafia-style thought process. Don't come after my family. Don't come after my wife. Like, and I, for better or worse, I probably should have way more insecurities. But my strength is, if 10 people say something negative and the 11th person says something positive, I remember it. And I also have the memory of a defensive back. You know, like, you get burned for 3 straight touchdowns, but you got a DB who slaps down a pass, and he's like popping his jersey and running around celebrating. I have the memory of a DB. I might get burned 3 times in a row, but when I make a play, I'm going to enjoy it. So I'm not a grudge guy. Like, I don't hold on to things. I don't get that angry. Laura, you know, my wife, says that the benefit for me is, I've never been a, hey, I need to talk to a psychologist, psychiatrist, or anything else. She's like, you get to go on the radio or your website and say exactly what you think, and at the end of that show, like, you have no weight on your shoulders. Like, you're free. People might be mad at you, but you've said exactly what you think. And I think one reason there's so much angst in this country is because so few people feel like they can say what they really think, right?
And that's sad.
I agree. And so I say exactly what I think, and I feel, to a large extent, I speak for a lot of people who don't think they can say what they think.
I will tell you, I was. There's a guy that is broadcasting, I'll just say, in this area today that I was talking to. And we were talking about you, and he said, I wish I had the balls to do what Clay does, but my employer would fire me. I would get unfollowed by all of these certain people. I can't do what he does.
And I don't care. I mean, yeah. I think that's the other.
Fortunately, you've gotten to the point. I mean, you took that chance because it could have gone another way for you.
Yeah, possibly. But also, like, I care what, you know, my son's sitting over here. Who's unfortunately
eating a bag of dicks,
yeah,
by the way.
You probably thought that was funny.
Stop winking.
He's a boy, after all. I think, you know, like, in general, I'm not somebody who I want to be a really good dad, and I think I am. And I want the people who know me well to believe that they can trust me and that I'll be straightforward with them. And I think that I am. And so I am a relatively small circle of people that I care about. And I really don't care about the larger world that much in the context of what people think about me, right?
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't really impact me.
Well, hey, look, we're talking to Clay Travis, founder of Outkick, part of the Fox family. This is Last Call in the Next Round, presented by Redmont Vodka. We're live at Innisfree. We've got one more drink coming. So what did you think about the John Daly?
I mean, the John Daly I like. What is
You're
this?
You're going to love this. This is,
I feel like we're in the Bahamas and like we just...
No. Went. What color does that remind you of? A little Ole Miss? This is the Joey Freshwater.
Oh, that's great. In Innisfree, after all. Where so, he made a name, where he got the name Joey Freshwater.
So I hear that he liked Redmont Vodka and Powerade mix. That's what this
is. Oh, God. This is like, I have no money. I'm 19 years old.
I'm going to black out and fall in a bush tonight.
I am hanging out with my boys, and all we got in the refrigerator is some Gatorade or some Powerade or whatever else, and we're going to mix it. I've been there, by the way. Done a lot of this over the years, but I don't know if this is a refined palate, but I like the other two more than I like this one.
We'll power through this one. Just a few more questions for you, and we'll let you go. We know you're busy. Okay, weirdest celebrity encounter you've ever had?
In terms of them knowing me or me knowing them?
Either or, and just a weird situation. Like, you know, back in the day, I went to a couple of those Maxim Super Bowl parties, and you would see some people in there just randomly doing some weird stuff.
So one of the things that still blows my mind is when people that... Let me start with this one. So several years ago, Matt Leinart's turned into a good friend, so that's a crazy story in and of itself. But we finished, we were working out at Fox, and it was Halloween weekend, basically. It was like, you know, the weekend before, the weekend after. And he said, hey, what are you doing tonight? I was like, I got nothing going on. He's like, hey, do you want to go to Nick Lachey's Halloween party?
Yes, I do.
100%. You know, he's married to Vanessa DeMillo, has an amazing house. It's not a huge party, probably, you know, 80 people there or something. And so go get a costume. Roll in. There's a ton of celebrities there.
What did you dress up as?
I went as... So the theme of the party was dead celebrities. So I had to go on Hollywood Boulevard, like, I think it was Halloween.
And of course they had a theme if it's L.A., right?
Yeah, it was dead celebrities at the Halloween party. And so I think I went, like, there wasn't that many costumes available, and I think I was, like, dead George Washington or something, right? Like, my costume wasn't great, but I was there, and Zach Morris, a.k.a. Mark Paul Gosselaar, is standing there. And I swear to God, Mark Paul Gosselaar went as Bruce Jenner. This is right after Bruce Jenner came out as Caitlyn Jenner.
I mean...
It's a hysterical costume, right? But I loved growing up Saved by the Bell. And I was like standing next to him. And I'm like, I don't know, D-list celebrity. So the best thing that can happen for me is when somebody else comes up and introduces me as somebody that that person should know, like, because we're on, like, I'm not trying to be like a, you know, I want to get a picture taken, but I can't, I don't want to be like the guy getting a picture.
You are bigger than Nick Lachey now.
I don't know if that's true, but I went to Liner and I was like, hey, can you go get Mark Paul Gosselaar and be like, hey, this is my buddy Clay. He's on TV with me to meet Mark Paul Gosselaar, because then he'll talk to me as an equal.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'm just going to be some fanboy. And so Liner, who, by the way, went dressed as Batman, which made no sense. He totally bombed on the thing. But him getting Mark Paul Gosselaar so we could meet was pretty wild.
I think Zach Morris probably won the costume of the night. Two more quick ones, and I'll let you go. One person you'd love to interview.
Well, I mean, right now, I mean, we've been trying to get him. I would love to have a long conversation with Fauci. Because I think he only, Dr. Fauci, I think he only goes on with people who are going to, like, genuflect at the altar of Dr. Fauci. And I think there are tons of questions that are interesting that he hasn't ever answered. So I'd like to talk to Dr. Fauci from a, you know, sort of celebrity media culture. I'm a big fan of Larry David. I think it would be super cool to get to meet Larry David and or play a round of golf with him. No, those would be kind of the guys, I think, that would that immediately come to mind.
Okay, so you've written a couple of great books, Republicans Buy Sneakers Too,
yeah,
Dixieland Delight, but also Man the Book. Best quote from Man the Book.
Oh, there's so many ridiculous ones in there.
We used to read a quote live on the air back when I did a show with Ian Fitzsimmons years ago.
I was 25 years old, and, you know, I remember... all of my buddies and I came up, and the idea was it's a list of man rules, satirical, ridiculous, absurdly funny, for men who aren't women in the 21st century. Because at that time that we wrote it, like 15 or 16 years ago, the idea of a metrosexual was kind of ascendant, right? That term has disappeared, and now probably been replaced by the woke culture, for lack of a better term. But the, you know, what I try to live by now, I'll just kind of synthesize it, is the general life advice that I give is don't be a pussy, right? Take risks. Because there's a lot of people who are afraid to take risks. But analyzing risk in an intelligent fashion is important. So you can say DBAP, which is don't be a pussy, and we've sold thousands of those shirts. But I also say SBAP, which is sometimes be a pussy. And people are like, what do you mean by that? And I was like, well, you know, if you're in Africa alongside of a crocodile-infested river and somebody says, I'll give you $100 if you swim across that river, and you say no and they call you a pussy, you'll be like, sometimes you should be a pussy, right? There's good risk and there's bad risk. And so to me, and this is larger picture stuff, what I think oftentimes ends up distinguishing failure from success is risk analysis. Is this a good payoff? Is this a bad payoff? And certainly when you're talking about private equity and hedge fund guys who make billions of dollars, they're the best in the world at that. But I think every individual in their own life has to make those choices. And let me, and this is a little bit of life advice that I found to be successful too. If you want to be successful in life, I think you have to prepare yourself for making difficult decisions on a regular basis. And I don't know whether this was unique to me or whether lots of other people do it too, but starting at a young age, 16, 17 years old, you would look at a difficult choice, analyze the choice, and pick which one you thought was the best, even though I had no call on whether or not to make it. And that helps you with doing that analysis from a risk perspective, right? And what I would say is, I mean, that's really kind of the foundation of why I think I've had success, because I have a pretty good needle in terms of analyzing, oh, that's a risk worth taking, oh, that's not a risk worth taking. And I think a lot of people, you know, in my industry and in our industry, were like, oh, you can't do anything because COVID's happening. But no, I look at the data and try to make a rational, reasonable, sane decision. And I think a lot of people respond emotionally, and social media is an emotional medium, and I tend to be a fairly logical and rational guy.
Well, hey, this has been fun.
Yeah, for sure.
Appreciate the time. It's Last Call on the Next Round, presented by Redmont Vodka, live from the Innisfree Irish Pub, drinking the Joey Freshwater. Do you think we'll see him out tonight?
That would be amazing, wouldn't it? I think he's got too much money at
Cheers,
stake.
Though.
Cheers.
Good
it was
to see
awesome.
You, brother.
It was fun to see you. Congratulations to you guys on the new venture. I know it's a, to your point, we talked about it some, and I congratulate you guys on taking a risk because, and I say this for everybody, the only way you can really control your future is by having a stake in owning your future. And whether it's a small business or big business or anything else, if anybody else can decide to fire you, it's hard to be honest.
And you can try to be honest now, and you don't have to worry as much about other things.
100%.
Yeah, which is great.
Yeah. Good to see you guys.